My name's Jeremy Bennett. I am chair of the BCS Open Source Specialist Group. So I'd like to welcome you all here this afternoon and introduce you to our workshop leader and a colleague of mine, Philip Krones. We're going to run a two-hour session, then a half-hour break, then a two-hour session. So we'll finish if you're in the UK and 7 p.m. if you're in Germany and well, other times in other parts of the world. So over to you, Philip.
Thanks for the introduction. Welcome, everyone. I'm Philip Krones. I have prepared a slide to introduce myself. On GitHub, my name is Flip1995, because that's my birth year. And I'm a member of the Rust programming language organization on GitHub. And I think since this year I'm the lead of the clip of the Rust Linda, and for the last 2 years I was a maintainer of the Rust Linda. And yeah, my background is in software and compiler engineering and artificial intelligence. For this talk, the part of the software engineering, and of course Rust will be important. So the people who were here before should already have done this. I have prepared a repository for this workshop. There will be tasks in this workshop you should do to get familiar with Rust, to try out Rust compiler, to try a tooling of Rust, and just to get to know the language and aspects of the language you will need to get started with Rust. Important notes are also in the shared notes section of a big blue button, which you can find on the in the top left corner of your screen in big blue button. The repository will also be linked there. Yeah, you can either fork it or just clone it. That's you can choose what you want to do. If you fork it, you can push your own commits. If you don't fork it, you can create commits, but then you can't push it. So you decide what you want to do here. About this workshop, so there are two parts. It doesn't mean that part one will be completely in the first section of the workshop before the break, and part two will be in the second section of the workshop after the break. We see how far we get with part one in the first section and do the rest of part one in the second section. And yeah, the reason for this is that part one is the essential things I want to get across about Rust. After that, we do, if we have time, a bit of advanced Rust stuff, where I just talk about things that are possible in Rust, that you can do more in Rust, so that that you aren't surprised if you see some syntax or some other things in Rust that you haven't seen in this workshop. But we might have to skip this part to have more time for embedded Rust stuff. And at the end, we also do a question and answer about 10 to 20 minutes, depending how much time we have. Yeah, so that's the plan for this workshop today. So we start with part one. Part one will include introduction to the ecosystem of Rust, what you have to get to work for this workshop or already got to work in the setup session. Then we talk about basic Rust, which is just syntax of Rust, the main things you have to know about Rust to get through this workshop. And then we talk about features in Rust, like pattern matching, error handling, iterators, good practices, and then generics and traits. And after all this, you are ready for the first project, which will combine everything we learned before in a project I prepared for you. And yeah, after every section, I have prepared a task that you can do and try things out. And yeah. Most tasks also have a bonus section. If you are fast, you can just run through the task itself and then try to tackle the bonus section, which oftentimes is a little bit harder and you might have to read the documentation. But that is good because the documentation of Rust is great and you learn to love it, I'm sure. Another important thing, if you have any questions for me or about the thing we do, even when you do during the time you do the task and I stop talking, just ask a question in chat, and me or Philip Herron will answer the question for you. Philip Herron is typing and he typed hello, smiley. Yeah, Philip Herron is also experienced in Rust and will help me out today with answering questions. And also important, there are no stupid questions. Don't hesitate to ask anything. Probably Philip and I also had the same questions when we started with Rust. It's just when you learn new things, everything is new, and feel free to ask everything. We try to answer as best as we can. Okay, let's start with the ecosystem. What you should have prepared is RustUp and Cargo. RustUp is the toolchain manager for Rust, and Cargo is the build tool for Rust, build tool and package manager for Rust. And if you now type in cargo new hello world, then change to the directory hello world. You have to do this in your terminal or command line, and then run cargo run. You should get the output hello world. Let's try this out. If you have successfully done this, press A. If you weren't able to do this, press B. I will see what you press. No one else will see what you press. So if you want to, you fail to do this, then press B and let me know.
Philip, could you go back a slide so we can remind what we were trying to do?
Yeah, sure. Later on, I also prepared for every task README, so you don't have to rely on the slides. Jeremy, can you change your vote after you voted?
So what can I change?
Can you change your vote on the poll after you already voted?
You can't. I mean, that's the nature of polls. Yeah, I got it working. I just switched to a new tab and forgotten to source bash us because I hadn't logged back in again.
Okay, but that's good to know.
Find cargo and Rust. Yeah, but I solved it about 3 seconds after hitting no.
So there are some people still missing. Oh yeah, I could put the commands in shared notes, but later on there will be readmes where everything is listed, what you should do, so you can read up on them yourself. Okay, So the one vote was by Jeremy. With the question that I should put up the slide again. I will keep that in mind if it's applicable. So I think everyone got this running. If not, please write in the chat. I will give you another minute and then we'll move on. Oh, in the meantime, I can introduce you to the official mascot of Rust. Rust has a mascot, and it's this guy here. He is called Ferris. It's a crab, and yeah, you will find Ferris on the slides later on also. He helped me with rubber duck debugging. Spinach? Why spinach? Oh yeah. I don't know why it is a crab, but someone drew a crab and everyone liked it, and now it's a crab, and it's called Ferris. Okay. Oh yeah. It's really cute. Anyway, let's move on. We got this. Okay, let's talk about the toolchain. So what you install initially is the Rust Toolchain Manager, RustUp. With RustUp, the advantage of it is versus installing like a Debian package or an Arch Linux, another package of Rust, you can use it to install other toolchains. If you use Python before, there is PyEnv where you can install different Python versions. And with RustUp, you can install different toolchains, you can install different components, which we will talk about soon. You can even install different targets for cross-compilation, which we'll get to in the end of the workshop in the embedded Rust part. And it's pretty convenient to just manage your toolchains. If a new Rust version comes out, which happens every 6 weeks, you can just update with RustUp update, and you have the newest toolchain installed. Everything works from there. So you don't have to go through your package manager, wait until a new version in your package manager is released. If you install RustUp on the Rust website, Philip, can you put a RustUp website in the shared notes, please? That would be great. Yeah, with RustUp, you can just manage all your toolchains, all your needs, all your tools you need for Rust, and even embedded development is possible with RustUp, and it should be really simple to use. And if you have problems, that's a bug and you should report it. So yeah, RustUp, great tool for managing your toolchains. So with every Rust installation, there comes Cargo. Thanks. Cargo is the toolchain manager, is the package manager for Rust, and also the build tool for Rust. With Cargo, you can build your packages, you can run the lint on your packages, you can format your packages, you can publish your packages. In Rust, a package or your program is called crate. So with Cargo, you compile your crate, you test your crate, you format your crate, and you do pretty much everything with Cargo in Rust. So if you want to compile your project, your crate, you run cargo build. If you want to test your crate, you run cargo test. You'll also see this later in a task. So I don't want to get too deep into this. You can compare cargo kind of a bit to NPM if you used that before. So you can also install external packages to for your on your computer with cargo. So yeah, you will use cargo a lot today. So I don't want to be stuck here on this slide. You will use it later on all the time. And the two important tools today we will use is first Rust Format, which is the official code formatting tool for Rust. And the second tool is Clippy, which is the official linter or static code analyzer for Rust. Of course, I have pretty big opinions on Clippy and think it's a great tool because I am a team lead for this project. But yeah, tooling of Rust is great, at least the basic tooling for Rust. And yeah, with that, we come to our first task. You find the first task in the 00 Rust format directory. Let me share my screen so I can show you that. Can someone confirm that the font size is big enough? Thanks. Okay. So if you have the repository open in your terminal or command line and type ls or ls minus l, you will see a list of directories from 0 to 10, and this will be the task for today. Let's go into the first task, 00 Rust format. Again, okay, you will see a cargo toml. This is the file where you put the information about your crate. So you put here the name of your crate, the version, the author, the edition, and later on we will see that you can also put the dependencies here, which will be different crates you use in your own crate. You don't have to provide any makefile or so for Rust and write makefiles or cmake configuration. You just collect everything in this Rust toml file you will need for your crate, and cargo will automatically build it down and download it. So that's great about Rust. The next thing is every task will provide a README file. In a README file, you see a short description why we do the task and what the task is about. The first task is about checking that you have Rust format installed successfully and you can run cargo format. Yeah. And now it's your turn. Please try this out. And if you manage to run this in the you have to be in the Rust format directory, then press A. If you have questions, please ask. Oh, Alaric, have you installed everything with RustUp, or do you use Debian package? Can you run RustUp self update? 1 second. Oh, you shouldn't run cargo install Rust format. That will do something else. you should abort this, you should run just cargo format and it should work. So cargo FMT in the Rust format directory. Oh, are you on Mac? Andy, it seems that you don't have Rust format installed then. If you run Rust format, it shouldn't produce any output. It should just do its thing. Alaric, try to remove the file Rust toolchain. So type that in your command line and then try cargo format again. I thought I'd provide a new Rust toolchain format file, but that seems to cause problems. Huh. Okay, perfect. Andy, JPP, did you get to run? You get it to work? Oh, Andy, you shouldn't build Rust format. That shouldn't be necessary. You can cancel this with Control C. Sanja, sorry if I butcher your name. You mean what the letters stand for in TOML? I think it's the initials of the author of the file format. Yeah. TOML stands for Tom's obvious minimal language. It's just a file format, which is pretty useful. So you will find this format all across Rust projects for different use cases, with the main use case being the cargo TOML file. Julian, I don't think I'm able to stop recording.
Right, I did it for you.
Yeah, don't thanks. Know why. I'll let you know if you, we start, should start record. Okay, moving on. So it seems that it this work on mostly everyone's machine. So yeah, after it works, the file should look like this, which is shown on the screen. You don't have to understand this file. It should just look like somewhat like this. And in the best case, it should look exactly like this, because cargo format should format everything on every machine the same. If it does, great. Okay. Now I think everyone got it to work. Perfect. Let's move on with the presentation. So next up is a small experiment. If the experiment is, you will get error messages from Rust or from the lint tool Clippy, and you should just apply the error messages without knowing anything about Rust. This is a test if the Clippy error messages are good enough. If they're not, I have to fix them after the workshop. So a Rust error message looks like this. So you have at the top the error message with an error code. In this case, this is the error that you try to assign a wrong type to a variable. And then it explains, we expected to see U size, but we found U16. It shows you why it expected this this type, and it shows how you can fix this error. And it will show you, oh, you can change this to U size, and then everything should work. And most of the error messages in Rust are formatted like this. So you get an error, you get an explanation why the error appears, and you get an explanation how to fix the error. It might not look always like this, but most of the time, error messages in Rust look like this. And now the experiment. Can you fix Rust errors without knowing Rust? So for this, I share my screen. Go to the 01 Clippy directory. And then you will again find a README here. In this README, again, there are steps how you can fix the things here. So you should run cargo Clippy, and then you get some error messages, and you should try to fix these errors without knowing anything about Rust code. And then after you think you fixed them, run cargo Clippy again and repeat this process until you fixed it. I will give you 5 minutes. If you don't manage to fix all the errors, that's completely fine. You don't know, I haven't explained Rust to you yet. It's just an experiment for me. But please let me know if you were able to fix the errors Clippy shows you. And if you did, press A. If not, press B. So 5 minutes from now. So after finishing this experiment, 8 people managed to fix the errors Clippy put out. We got some feedback with what Clippy can improve in the error messages. And I will get to that after the workshop, and I will improve this. So Let's switch back to the slides. So yeah, 8 people managed to fix the errors in 5 minutes. One person managed to press no before I ended the poll. The rest probably struggled fixing the errors. And that's fine, because I haven't explained Rust to you yet. And we will continue with this right now. Except you have any questions, of course. Let's wait. Questions? Okay, that doesn't seem to be any questions. So yeah, let's look at basic Rust. So Rust has a little bit different syntax from programming languages you might know. It's somewhere between, I would say, Python and C. So in Rust, function definitions, for example, don't start with the type at the beginning, but start with a keyword, fn, function. Then it follows the function name. After that, a list of arguments follows. That's pretty standard, like in pretty much every programming language. But arguments, again, the type comes second after the after a colon. And at the end of the function, you have the return type, which is shown with an arrow. So dash bracket to return type. So this means we take an integer with 32 bit and a boolean, and we return an unsigned integer with also 32 bit. In Rust, if expressions don't need parentheses around the condition. And Rust will also complain if you put a parenthesis around the condition. Next, in Rust, you can return, as you know from other languages, just return the thing you want to return, put a semicolon afterwards. To print stuff in Rust, you use a macro. We will get to macros later in the advanced Rust stuff, but for now you just have to know that to print stuff in Rust, you can use a println macro, and formatting in this macro looks like this. If you want to insert the value of an argument here, you can put braces inside the string you want to put out, and then after a comma, you can list all the arguments you want to format inside the string you put in the print line. And last but not least about Rust syntax, the last expression in the function without a semicolon will be returned. So for the last expression in the function, we don't need a return value. We just write the expression here, arg plus 1 as u32. So we add 1 to our input argument and convert it to an unsigned integer. And then Rust will return it because it is the last argument in the function, or the last expression in the function. And that's pretty convenient, as you will see when writing Rust code. Yeah, that's all to the basic syntax of Rust. Next is, if you write a binary in Rust, you will include a function called main. Main doesn't take any arguments, and main returns the unit type. The unit type is pretty much what you know from other languages called the void type. But special thing about a unit type, if something will return the unit type, you don't have to write it. you can just leave it out. And function main without any return value is exactly the same as function main with a returning unit type. And you can think about of the unit type as a tuple without elements. So just an empty type. And yeah, the unit type is some kind of special thing in Rust. But just know that unit type is practically the void type for Rust for now. And you don't have to write this type most of the time, because if you return the unit type, if you return nothing, it applies that you return the unit type. And another cool thing in Rust is that everything is an expression. This has the effect that you can assign pretty much everything to every variable. So you define a variable in Rust with the let keyword. You don't have to specify a type. Rust will figure this out for you. And then you can, for example, assign an if expression. So if b, we assign 42. And if not b, we assign 21. So we can also assign something else here. So the question by Andy is if we assign here something without any type, an integer without any type specifier, by default Rust will choose for integers type i32, so a signed integer with 32 bits. In this case, we kind of specify the type of x, but not here, but in the return value. So when we will put u32 here, then Rust will assign an unsigned 32-bit integer to x. But since we have i32 here, Rust will assign a signed 32-bit integer to x. But the default integer type is i32. So if you don't specify anything, for an signed integer with 32 bit will be assigned. One moment. Another question is, what if let me share my screen real quick. So let's write this. Let x is 42, and now we force it that it is a 64 unsigned integer, for example, and then we return x. We can write x if block here, or if expression. Let's do this. And then I see the font size is a little bit small. Can I change this here? No. That should work. Okay, so now we tell Rust X has the type unsigned 64-bit, and we assign either the 42 or 21 to it, but we return an i32 type. Let's ask Rust what Rust thinks about it. And it says mismatched types. We expected to return i32 type, but we found u64 because we specified the type unsigned integer 64 bits here. And then we returned it. And Rust suggests what we want to do here, but this is a little bit complex. We get to what this means later. Yeah, so we could, for example, write SI32, and then it should work. Yeah, except we don't use the function bar anywhere. Did that answer your question, Alan? Perfect. That's nice to hear. Okay. Let's quickly talk about primitive types in Rust. You already saw the integer types. In Rust, when you specify integer, you know exactly how many bits that integer will have. A somewhat exception is the usize and the isize type. This will have that many bits as your architecture has a pointer size. So on a 64-bit architecture, you will have 64-bit integer with the usize type. Yeah, so you can specify how much bits your integer should have, and you can specify if it should be unsigned or signed. And I just see that I forgot floating point types. So float and double in Rust, this is F32 and F64. Can I add a note here somehow? So yeah, you have F32 and F64 as types for floating point numbers. Then you have bool, which is a 1-byte type, which is either true or false. There's no implicit conversion between integers and booleans, and there's also no implicit conversion between any integer types. If you want to have a different type, you have to explicitly convert the type. Then we have char. Char is different than in C or C++, and it doesn't have 1 byte, it has 4 bytes, and char represents a Unicode character. So it could also be an emoji or something. Yeah. And then you, of course, have string as primitive, more or less primitive types. You have two types of this. One is reference to n string, and the other one is string. The difference between this is the string with a capital S is allocated on the heap, and you need an allocator for it. And n string is can be allocated on the stack, and is practically just a pointer to where your string on lives in memory. The string versus str thing you will notice later when you use Rust more. The next topic is a little bit more complicated. This is about why Rust is a memory safe language. If Rust compiles, you won't get any seg faults because of some memory errors. That's the greatest feature about Rust and why you should use Rust over C and C++. If you worry about memory issues of memory access or something, then Rust guarantees to compile time that you won't have any issues with your memory. And now I want to talk about how Rust can guarantee this. Rust implements the ownership model. Ownership means that an instance of a type belongs to exactly one variable. And in this case, the string Rust is cool belongs to S. And if now we call take s, then s will be given to the function take. So in Rust speak, we say that s is moved into take. So now s belongs to take, and take can do whatever it wants with it. And after we gave it to take, we can't use it anymore in main, because we transferred the ownership from s into the function take. And Rust will also error here if you write this code, because we move the ownership of s to take, and now we can't use it anymore in main. Now is the time where you now is the perfect time where you can ask questions about this. So the okay, DSM gets ahead of ourselves. Is unsafe an option to break this? The short answer is no, but we may get to this in the second part of the workshop. The other question by Julian is, could take have returned s again, and in main we say s is take. I think the best way to find out this out is to try it out. And I just prepare this. And I will share my screen. So we pretty much have the same setup here as we have had in our slides. We have a function take that takes s, and we pass s to take. Let's run this, and here we see borrow of move value s, move occurs because s is type string, and take takes the value moved here, and value borrowed here after move. So what this means is pretty much we moved s into take. The question now is if we could return s here, and then later use it here. So let's try this out, and we get another error. Cannot assign twice to immutable variable s. And this brings us to the next thing. In Rust, if you define a variable, this variable is always immutable. So right now you may be asked, why is a variable mutable? If I define a variable, I want to do things with it. But if you use Rust, you notice that most of the time, you don't modify any variable you set before. So if we want to do this, we have to add the keyword mut before s. And now we can do this. And it works. Currently our string is empty. Let's change that, and we see our output is Rust. Another thing we can do here is we don't have to find this as mutable. We can redefine s here. So if we write let s, then the new s will shadow the old s, and we have a new s here. And we can then use the new s. So we in Rust, we can shadow variables, and we can also mutate them. Another question by Andy, is it just for heap allocated strings? Yes, I will get to this shortly. mut applies just to the pointer, not the value of the string. No, this is not a this string from is it doesn't create a pointer. It creates an object. Yeah, exactly. S is S plus one. So. Can't hear you. Okay. Sanjay, that might be you. Okay. So the question was, if we also need this for like integers, if we assign some integer to S and then try to add one to the integer, we also need to say that this is mutable. So that works. But back to the string example. So a string new or string from, whatever you use, doesn't create a pointer to the string, but it creates an actual string, which is then assigned to S. And then S owns the string, and S can choose to give away the ownership to, for example, another function. So why does it matter if ownership is moved to take, if take can't mutate it in any bad ways? This is important because in Rust ownership model, a value can only be owned by exactly one thing. There can't be a situation where you have a value that is assigned to multiple things. And if you assign something to multiple things, you will get problems. A good example for the assignment of something to multiple string to multiple things is, for example, pointer aliasing, which is a problem you might stumble into if you're using C or C++, which can get pretty bad. But in Rust ownership model, everything can only be owned by exactly one thing. But that brings me to my next point. How we can modify our code so that we can pass in this string to the function and still use it afterwards. And how we can do this is to just pass a reference and not pass the actual thing. And the reference is then practically a pointer. And with this, we reference the string here and pass the reference into our function. And then we can use S afterwards again in our print line. This is called borrowing. So in Rust, we have one owner of something. In that example, we have S is the owner of string, and S can borrow the value of itself to other things by providing a reference to the value. And this is done with the ampersand operator. And now only a reference is passed into the borrow function. And with that, we create a reference here, pass it to the borrow function. And when the borrow function returned, the reference is no longer needed and is dropped. Yes, I'm not quite sure if I get your question. Do you mean if there are conventions how you should name things? Then the answer is yes. And oh, yeah. So string is a type or a struct in the Rust standard, and structs are named with a capital S, and variables are named with a lowercase s. And if you violate the naming conventions of Rust, as Philip said, Rust will warn you about this. So. See this, for example, if we name this str, then Rust will say a variable str should have a snake case name. Okay, but back to the topic. So in Rust, everything has exactly one owner, but this owner can choose to borrow the thing it holds to another thing, which in this case, S will borrow the value of the string to the borrow function. And with that, we can use S afterwards because it only borrowed the value and that didn't give the value to the function. Yeah. So another thing how we can circumvent this is if we clone our string and pass the clone of our string. When you start with Rust, you should clone often. So if you have any problems, just clone the thing. You will get a performance hit of your during runtime, but getting things working in the beginning is better than having optimal performance. You can optimize your performance afterwards. When you start with Rust, just clone things and don't care so much about the performance of your code. Yeah, so here we can also clone S and move the clone into take, and then we can use S afterwards because we only moved a clone of S into take and not as itself. And Rust has another concept except for clone. This concept is called copy, and copy are small types, like integer is copy. And copy types, like integers, you don't have to clone them explicitly, but if you pass an integer in a function like take, it just copies them implicitly. So it's like if you would call x.clone, but because x is a small type and therefore implements copy, it will just clone it for you implicitly, and then you can use it afterwards. So in take, you won't have a pointer to x, but you will have the value of x. You can work with. So, yeah. And as I told before, in Rust, everything is unmutable by default. So if you pass just a reference to something into a function, you won't be able to mutate the thing behind the reference. Rust will error if you try to do this. So for example, if we try to modify s in the take function, Rust will error because we didn't declare s as mutable. If we want to pass s mutable, and mutate it in the mutate function, we have to write and mut keyword s, and then we can mutate it here. But in this case, it doesn't work because we borrowed s immutably and then we borrowed s mutably. This is a problem in Rust because ref s now has a reference to s, but in mutate we can mutate s, and because s is a string that's allocated on the heap, when we mutate s and for example extend s and make it longer, then it might be reallocated, and then the pointer ref s has might not work anymore. So Rust will error here because we have a immutable reference to s and a mutable reference to s at the same time. That is not possible in Rust. So this is also not possible with unsafe code, and you won't get Rust code compiled where you have simultaneously a immutable reference and a mutable reference to something in your program. We can fix this by swapping out the two operations. So if we put mutate and mut s before the before getting the shared reference, we are able to mutate s because we do it before we take a reference to s. And yeah, this is possible because when we pass a mutable reference to s into the function, then this mutable reference is no longer needed after we call the function. The Rust compiler will notice and will drop the mutable reference at the end of the statement, and then we can again immutably borrow the reference later for some use case. It's also important to know that if you have a mutable reference to something, you only can ever have exactly one mutable reference to it and no other reference to it. If you immutably borrow something, you can do this as often as you want, because if you don't mutate it, everyone can look at it at the same time and it doesn't cause problems. Yeah, the next thing would be to add a task for you. So if you have any questions about ownership and references, please ask now. Well explained. Thank you. Perfect, and I would say let's get started with the task. If you go to the O2 basics stuff, you will again find README. Yeah, this time it's a little bit longer because it kind explained cargo to you a bit, what commands you can run with cargo, like check, build, and run. And yeah, there's also a bonus task. If you run through the basic task, you can try to do the bonus task. Yet it shouldn't be that difficult to do the bonus task, but yeah, so just try to do as much as you can. I think a good time spent for this is about 10 minutes. You mainly have to run cargo build and try to fix the things in this crate. So 10 minutes from now. remove the semicolon here. The next thing is mismatch types again in the expected use size. Also a quite easy fix. We can just change this to use size and we're good. The error is gone away. And now a bit harder. I saw the comment that this is that some people struggle with the type to give x. And if we look just below here, we see something called the turbo fish here. Turbo fish is the name in Rust for this syntax. For example, we can specify type a function should return if it takes a generic argument by writing colon colon and then brackets around the type. So it gets this type here. And we can paste it also here. So the collect function or method, you will use this very often if you use iterators and work with collections in general. The collect takes something and transforms it into another collection. And when you use collect, you have two most of the time you have to specify the type or part of the type. And here we have to specify that we want to have a vector. And we either do this by writing the type onto the variable x colon back, and then we can leave the actual type of the vector out because Rust will infer it. And in this case, Rust will infer the type i32 because we use an integer here, and the default type for integers is i32. And yeah, so we can specify the type right after variable. And the second thing is we can use the so-called turbo fish, which is this syntax here in the comment, and then we can put a type in between those brackets. So here we can put a type, and it will do exactly the same as specified in the type here, but sometimes this is nicer, sometimes specifying the type right at the beginning is nicer. You have to decide what you like more and then use that. So, and now if you specify the type, this error is gone. Going to the next, here we pass the wrong type because we have pass an integer instead of a bool. Easy fix, just pass a bool. Then we forgot to add a format thing here. We can do this by just adding the correct format document here. Yeah, the problem we discussed before, everything in Rust is immutable. So we can add just mut here and this also works. And another warning that's simply fixed is this. Rust detects, oh, we panic here unconditionally. And panic means we abort our program and Rust knows, okay, this code is never reached. So we can also delete it and nothing changes semantically in the semantics of our program. And here we have the problem we discussed on the slides, that we move the value into quarks and then we can't use it afterwards here. So we can fix this by borrowing, but when we do this, Rust says quarks got a type string, got a type reference to string, but it expected just a string. And we can fix this by just passing a string here. And last but not least, this error. Here was also the question how to fix this, because there are many ways to fix this. And the easiest way is if we just move the mutable borrow here, because we don't need a mutable borrow already here. We only need it here in the quads. So we can also mutable borrow it here and don't have to mutable borrow it before the macromania. So this was practically the whole fix. And you can even go even further and don't assign it to X, but just pass endmod S here. And that also fixes it. And now everything should be fixed. And if we now run cargo run, it will produce all our output. And at the end, it will panic because we called panic unconditionally. And it also tells us the message we put into panic. And it tells us where it panics. So if you go to the file to line 74, we will find our panic call and the reason why it panicked. So it panicked while panic and the string we pass into this. All right. That's the explanation for the basic task. The next thing would be after Rust is satisfied and doesn't emit any warnings or errors, we run cargo Clippy. And Clippy has some more opinions here. The first thing is if you write X is X plus one, you can just write X plus equals one, which is assign assign add operator, which does exactly the same as X is X plus one. In Rust, there's no pre and post increment operator. If you want increment something by one, you have to write X plus equals one. And the second thing it complains about, if you pass a reference to a string, you usually want to pass a reference to the str thing. If you want to know more about this, go to this website and Clippy, the Clippy documentation will explain to you why it complains about this. So, yeah. Let's check the poll. Okay, this was not that satisfying. 6-4 is the result of the poll. Yeah, I hope my explanation how to fix the code made things clearer. If not, and if you still have questions, let me know. Oh yeah, I will push the fixed code in the repository into the branch solution. But I will do this in the break in 15 minutes. First, now you saw you can also get all the warnings and error messages inside your editor, and you can use go to definition and everything in your editor, and you don't have to go open your command line, compile everything, and then go back to your editor all the time. And now I will explain to you how to do this. I will explain it to you only for Visual Studio Code. Personally, I use NeoVim with the plugin CogNVim, which works great, but setting this up takes a little bit longer than setting everything up in VS Code. Philip Herron uses Emacs with LSP mode, and if you want to know how to install it in Emacs, or in Vim, we can talk about this in the break. But now I will show you how to install it in Visual Studio Code. So if you use code or have code Visual Studio Code installed, Now is the time to open it up if you want to follow along. Okay, now you should see Visual Studio Code on my my screen share. So to get Rust IDE features, you have to go to extensions and then search for Rust Analyzer. So if you find this Rust Analyzer by Matt Klett, which is the author and maintainer of this project, just hit install. It will install the tool. And now if you open a Rust project, for example, the next task, the pattern matching task, and open a Rust file, VS Code will tell you, I don't have Rust Analyzer completely installed yet. Please press download now, and it will install Rust Analyzer. And if this bar is completed, you see here that you have 5 warnings. And now if you press Control and J, something like this opens up, and you will get the error messages here, and you can just click on it and it will display the errors here. So, and in VS Code it's the formatting is a little bit prettier, and you get more information than in Vim. So yeah, we get the error here, or other errors in other things. Or let's open something we already know, like the basics task. So we get this here, and the great thing is, increase the size a bit. If we hover over this with our mouse and select quick fix, then we can select the code action, just click on it, and Rust Analyzer will fix it for us. Same for this, quick fix, change U16 to U size. And that works. So practically, just go to VS Code, install Rust Analyzer, and if it's installed, open a Rust file and it will ask you to download Rust Analyzer. And if you have done this, then you're set and you should have all the IDE features in VS Code. Okay, not so easy in Jupyter. Yeah, I guess so. So first question, Rust sub component at Rust source gives me a lot of errors. Can you post errors? Best thing to do would be to send it to me in a private message, to not spam the public chat. Other question, I'm getting this message on VS Code. To properly function, the extension needs to know what toolchain you want to use. You can change the settings of an extension VS Code by going here, then pressing the wheel, and then extension settings, and then somewhere the toolchain should be Just search for it. Huh. Oh, I don't know this error. Do you have multiple toolchains installed? Dominic? Let's get to that in the break. That would be the best thing to do, I think. So does anyone else have problems getting a Rust Analyzer installed in VS Code? And also, Alan, we can figure out a problem with component add Rust source in the break. So, quick poll if you got it working for you. Happy with using Atom. Yeah, Philip, thanks for posting the link to Rust Analyzer Setup Guide. There should also be a guide for Atom there, I think. So here's the guide again in the chat. Okay. We now reached the time for a break. I see some people have installed it successfully, some haven't. I would suggest to Alan and Dominic that we meet in a breakout room during the break and also get you set up. And if anyone else has problems, just write in the public chat and we'll add you to the breakout room so that everyone is on the same page after the break. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Philip. I think Julian will be able to set you up a breakout room, and I will resume at 4 p.m. UK time. That's in half an hour. I'm going to drop off, in fact, for that half an hour. So I'll see you all later.
See you all later. Okay, it seems to me that most of the people are back. So let's continue. I hope in the break everyone got the Rust analyzer set up or VS Code or your editor. If not, that's not really a problem. You just have to use the command line and can't use the cool IDE features that are provided by Rust Analyzer together with VS Code. But that should still work. Another thing, the first part of the workshop before the break took a little bit longer than I expected, so I will drop a few things out of the workshop. And we probably won't get to the advanced Rust stuff at all. But this was anyway just filler if we got through it too fast. We will address embedded Rust though at the end. And there will still be a question and answer session at the end. So let's continue. The next topic is pattern matching in Rust. This is a bit lighter. Let's first go into structs and tuples. You can see this kind of like classes in other programming languages like C++ or Java. So a struct is just a structure which contains other data types, and you can then construct a structure by explicitly Oops, that was a misclick. By just assigning every value in the structure, and you can either define a struct by this with the braces and then putting a name plus a type for every field, or you can define a so-called tuple struct by using parentheses and just define types. You can then access in a tuple struct your fields by writing dot o or dot one would access the boolean. If you have a struct, doesn't matter if you have a tuple struct or a regular struct with name fields, you can implement it with a so-called impl block. This looks like this. You write impl t and all the functions he in here will be available either through t colon colon new, or if it's a method which takes self as an argument, which is then the instance of the type, you can write then t dot self. And for example, constructors in Rust, so that you don't have to write this syntax with the braces, you can just implement a constructor in Rust, which you then can co then call. Constructors in Rust are usually called new or new underscore something. Yeah, but usually constructors in Rust just start with new. It's not a special function if it starts with new. It's just a convention that you start names of constructors with the name new. Yeah, for example, this into tuple function takes self. As you see, it takes self by value. That means it moves t. If you have an instance of t inside this method, and you can't use the instance of this method afterwards anymore because it was moved into the into tuple function and returns a tuple. This is another thing in Rust. You don't need data types like standard pair you have in C++. In Rust, you can just define tuples like this, and you can also add more types to it. For example, you could add U32, bool, I32, or even other structs to the tuple you want to return, and then it just returns a tuple, and you can have access to all the types there. And then something you might have read about Rust. Rust enums are pretty powerful. Rust enums, the variants are not just some integers, like for example in C, but you can give every variant in an enum a value. So for example, A has no value, it's just A. B has an unnamed value of type U32, and C has a named value with called R, A, with the type also U32. And you construct enums like this. You can also implement stuff on enums exactly the same as you do with structs. So you can implement methods on enumerations. Oh, and another thing in Rust, when formatting a string with println or other macros that support formatting, you can also name your variables you want to format and then specify it like this. A is A, B is B, and so on. So enums are pretty powerful. Enums in Rust are so-called algebraic data types. That means that if you have an enum and write a switch case, which is called match expression in Rust, you have to cover every case of the enum. So for example, if you only cover A and B of the enum, the Rust compiler will error here because you haven't covered every variant. You can fix this by just covering also C variant. And if, for example, now this enum E is from a grade or dependency you use, and the dependency adds another field or another variant to the enum, your grade will then produce an error when you update the dependency, and will say that you have to add that you also have to handle the other variant. Of course, Rust match expression also have something for the default case. It's the wildcard match operator, and with that, it just takes everything else that's so if E is not A and is not B, but something else, it might be C, it might be any future variant that is added to E, it will just go into the arm of the default value where the wildcard is. And yeah, so sometimes the match expression might be too much for your use case because you really only care about one variant of the enum. We will see examples for this later. Let's say we only care about the B variant of an enum, then you can also use the if-let syntax. If-let enum variant B is E, then we print this. And Rust implements a pretty powerful pattern matching system. So we only go into the body of this if-let expression if we have the variant B and the value inside this variant B has the value 16. And then inside here, we can be sure that we have that E is variant B and the value of this variant is 16. And Yeah, that's only the beginning of pattern matching that is possible in Rust. There's a whole chapter in the book about pattern matching you can read up on. So Rust has pretty powerful tools here. And now with your new IDE features, you might be a little bit faster going through the code. As always, if you have questions to the things I just told you, just ask. But you can try this also try this out right now. It's the 0-3 pattern matching. And the task is, as always, get it to compile. And if it does compile, you can read up on pattern matching if you want to, and also try out some of with pattern matching in the implement. So the errors are mostly just you haven't covered the area or that query. I noticed that I forgot to tell you something, and that's about this expression here. This derive. If you put before enum or struct a derive, it means that you want to derive this this attribute for this enum or struct. And debug means that if we derive this, we can then debug print our enum. So we can pass it to print line and it will print our enum in a way that is good for debugging. Yeah, so, but if we want to derive something, every type inside of our enum or our struct have to also implement this attribute or also derive this attribute. So for example, if we have some other type here, like our struct T or our struct S instead of the U32, then we couldn't derive debug because our struct T doesn't derive debug. We can fix this by also deriving debug for T, because U32 and bool both implement debug or derive debug. So yeah, so if you can derive such things for your structs and enums, which saves you implementation time. There's also, if you want to compare your struct with itself, you can just derive equals. And then you can use the equals equals operator with your struct. But you will see this in the task. So yeah, that's all you need for the task. And now, have fun. And as always, if you have questions or any remarks about the task or anything, just let me know in the public chat. Thanks for stopping the recording. I always forget about it. Okay, I think Rust Analyzer fails me. Ah, no, I'm just on the wrong branch. And by the way, I pushed the solution of the tasks until now on GitHub. So the first, from top down, the first error we find is S doesn't implement debug, so we can't derive debug here for E. So when we go to S to change this, we can just add a debug derive here, and the error is gone. Now S derives debug, so that means we can also derive debug for E. So next error is here, missing edge match arm. So that's pretty easy. We just have to write other match arms. We even have to write a match arm for B, because this match arm here, this syntax means we match on the first parameter and only visit these arms if X is equal to 42. So we haven't covered every other case of B, so we have to cover this somehow, and we do this by adding some thing here, and the same goes for C and D. If, for example, for two variants you want to write the same code, you can do this with the OR a pattern matching operand, and then write self D, and then write the same code for both of them. Oops. And same is for this here. Yeah. Let's just cut things short and go the short route and just wildcard case for the other things, which is just B in this case. And the next thing, this is a pretty easy error. Expected string found end string. If you use the command line, instead of the tool, it shows you you can just use the toString function on str, and if you do this, it will convert the str to a string. So I think the question I got was about this function here, some problems with the struggling with the push bool. So if we read the error message carefully, cannot borrow self.c as mutable as it is behind a end reference. Self is an end reference, so the data it refers to cannot be borrowed as mutable. Pretty long sentence for telling us to turn this into end mod self. And now we save this, we can push things to C, and the error message practically tells us we try to push something to a field of self, but self is itself not mutable, so we have to convert it to mutable. Let's look at the error message in the console, and it's us help consider changing this to be a mutable reference. And if we do this, it works. So most of the time, if you're not sure what you should do, ask the compiler first, and then do exactly what the compiler tells you. And most of the time, this will work. And afterwards, your program will do what you want it to do. If it doesn't work, you have to kind of work out yourself why it doesn't work. Because once the compiler fails you, you have bigger problems, because some things doesn't work out and the compiler can't reason anymore about your code. And yeah, that's it. Now we only have one. Yeah, not even have to spawning anymore. Yeah. So, and that's a great question. So let's look at this. Self D, and then we match on S. So if we match A, B, and C, and just use A and B empty, I think it is. Doesn't seem so. The compiler tells us, hey, you don't use C at all. And yes, the one thing you can do is to say C, I don't care about C, it should map to just a wildcard. If you want to ignore variables or have unused variables that should stay unused, you prefix them with, so if we have let x 42, Rust will want, yeah, Rust will output a warning, we don't use X, why is this here? If we know that it's okay that X is there and we want to keep it there, we can prefix it with underscore, and then there won't be unused warnings. Something like this is happening here. We assign or map the C in our struct to an underscore, which means we don't care about this. A shorter syntax for this is just to write dot dot, and it does the same. So, yeah. If we match on structs and only care about some fields, we write at the end comma, dot dot, and every other field we don't care about will be matched by the dot dot operator. Why does plain underscore work in some places but not there? So the reason is that this syntax here is just syntactic sugar of this. So yeah. So if you write A comma B comma C, it's syntactic sugar of A colon A comma B colon B comma C colon C. And you often just want to match on the real name of the field. If you don't want to match on the real name of the field, but on something other than the name of the field, for example, if one may want to match C to C2, really creative, we can write it like that. But to match to an unused variable like underscore C, we have to write it like this. Did this answer your question, Andy? That's why it doesn't work, why having an underscore here does work, is because this B is a tuple struct. Tuple struct fields are unnamed, so we don't provide a name, we just match the zero field of a tuple struct to the first thing we put in there, the second to the second, and so on. For other structs, like for a real struct like S, in pattern matching, we don't have to write all the fields in the order the struct has it in. We can just scramble them around, and they will get matched correctly because it matches with the name of the field. But with tuple structs, every field is unnamed, so we can't match with the name of the field, but it matches with the position. So there's no B dot colon B to match this. So we match directly to the name, if that's clear. So if you want to match to a different name, you have to use the colon syntax. For example, we can't write anything here, X. We either write the name like it is specified in the struct, so B, or we take the field called B and map it to colon to a different name, and then we can use the different name here. While the compiler issues a warning, Rust is kind of strict about conventions and defining what's idiomatic code, and so it prints warnings about this because Rust code should look pretty uniform across platforms. That's also why Rust provides an official linter, an official formatter, and so on. And also warns on if you get function names wrong and don't use snake case but camel case or something, Rust will warn you about this. So, yeah. It's pretty much that you write idiomatic Rust as often as possible. And it's just idiomatic to match to the name directly instead of providing a different name. Okay. And if we run Clippy afterwards, it will say this error message is kind of confusing for beginners because it's not clear what it means in the documentation. Here it is explained what it means. It means that normally if we move something into a function, then we call the function not to something, but into something, because we move something into this function and it's not available anywhere else. Another question is, if you write this, if the struct is then extended, for example by external crate, we won't get a warning when using the new version of S. If you write this, Clippy has a lint about this that you can enable if you want this lint, so that it tells you you should write exactly this. So specify the field, and now if the struct S gets a field added, the Rust compiler will error here. And try this out. So yeah, here. Pattern does not mention field D, missing field D. All right. Let's move on. The next topic is error handling and builds on the current topic about enumerations. So really important is in Rust, there is no null pointer. You won't have to deal with null pointer exceptions or anything like it. You can't return null from a function or anything. You don't have to deal with null pointer exception. But you can, for this, Rust has the enumeration called option. Option is either a value or it is nothing. So either it is a sum value or it is nothing. The difference to a null pointer is none, you have to deal with it because it's an enum. So you either have to match on it with you either have to match on the none value, or you have to write something to ignore it. So you can't overlook a null pointer anymore. So you can't accidentally return a null from something and then call a method on null and then get a seg fault or anything. Rust will prevent this exactly with this option type. So when you might return a null pointer in C or C++, you will now use option as a return value. And similar to option, there's result. The difference between option and result is that in the none case, which is called error in result, you can also assign a value. So that's good if you return either a value that is okay, and you want to return the value and everything worked out fine, or you want to return an error with some message. For example, you can put a string in here so that when you hit an error case, you return a string, and the user of your method can then print out a string and exit or something. So yeah, option, if you think you have to return a null pointer in Rust, you will use option. There are no null pointers in Rust. I just told you that you have to deal with options. Rust forces you to. So the first way to deal with an option is to call unwrap on an option. If you unwrap an option, either you will get the value back or your program will panic. Panicking means that your program will abort and will not continue. And yeah, Rust will then print where your program stopped and so on. So that's the first method. You should only ever call the function unwrap on an option if you're absolutely sure that your option can only be sum. Otherwise, you should deal with your option in some way. A way to deal with an option is to use some function like unwrap or. Unwrap or either unwraps your option and gives you the value. In this case of the opt, it will return 42. Or if we assign none instead of sum 42, we assign none to the option, it will give us 0 because we specify we unwrap either or we return 0 for our option. And yeah. Then we have convenience function like map, where we can use this is a closure, we'll get to that later in the talk, and then we can map from one value, from the option value, so we get here 42, and if x is 42, this option now contains true, so this map function would now return sum true, and if x would be something different than 42, this map function would return sum of false. So it doesn't return none if this condition isn't hit, but it returns it just returns sum false. The map or function is similar to the unwrap or. We do the same as in the map function in the case that option is sum, but if option should be none, then we will return false. and map or will either return false or will return this the evaluation of this expression. So in this case, it will return true. And don't worry that you get types in these functions wrong. Rust type checker will check all the types and then you will return the same type in every case. And some useful, all these methods are also available on the result type. So if you have a okay value, so a result type, you can also use unwrap, unwrap or map, map or, and so on. And you can also convert between option and result. Most of the time you want to convert from a result to an option, which you can do with the okay value. This is just a check that the value is okay. If it is, return some of that value. If it's not, then just ignore the error and convert it to none. The okay or function also exists where you can convert an option. If it's none, it will produce an error value with this value you specify here. So in Rust, it is pretty common that you have a function which returns a result, which calls in itself another function which also returns a result. And because you don't want every time you want to match on this function you call or call unwrap or somehow deal with this error, Rust provides this syntactic sugar, which means if we call foo and we get an error as a return value, then we just abort bar here and return the error up to the calling function of bar, and then the caller of bar has to deal with the error we got from foo. And if we get a usize here, so okay foo returns okay usize, then we just assign this usize value to res. That's everything this one single character, the question mark, does. So if we get an error from foo back, we just propagate the error up to the caller and the caller has to deal with it, or we unpack the value and assign it to res. So, yeah. Any questions? And now some more things you can try out. In the task 04 error handling. The bonus task is just to show you the documentation of this both types, and you can just try out some methods implemented on optional result. It might be quite hard for beginners, so don't worry if you don't get to this part. Let's do the task. This is mostly explaining things. There are no errors in this file. It's just a read through. So here the sledgehammer method unwrapping things. If we unwrap this, our program will panic. And if we try this out with cargo run, we get called option unwrap on a none value in line 38. And looking at line 38, we called unwrap on a none value. A good practice is instead of calling unwrap, you should call expect, because when we call expect on something, we don't just get you unwrapped something here in this line somewhere, but we get the message this should have been successful division by zero. And this is produced by exactly this expect call here. It will print the message you put in there, and it will in addition print the message the error value has. And then we have our default options, unwrap or 100. So if it's sum, we get a value of sum, otherwise we get 100, also zero. And there's also this method, which is unwrap or default. This unwrap or zero and unwrap or default is the same, because the default value in Rust of an integer is zero. So if we call unwrap or default on our diff error, we will get zero, because zero is the default value. And another method to deal with options or result often used is the multiplication, the match operation. So you match an option, and in the sum case you do something, and in the none case you do something else. Oftentimes, you only care about the sum or the okay value, and the error or none value, you just don't do anything. And if something returns none, that's okay, and then you don't do anything more in your function. And you, most of the time, you express this with this if-let syntax. There was a question: what this if-let syntax, how this is work, and how you should think about this. Practically, you can look at this let like every let assignment you do, like a let assignment like here above. But since you have a pattern here with the OK value, this let assignment can actually fail. And if it fails, the if will detect this and just do nothing. But if it succeeds and the diff OK, this is actually an okay value, then it will do the assignment, assign the value to well, and then it will go into the body and you can use the assigned value. And this is pretty much the same pattern matching syntax as in the match case. So you match this value in the match case to this value in the arm, and in the if-let case, you match this value to this other value. And yeah, everything else is bonus. I can pull it up real quick. So if you look at GitHub, the bonus task was just finding the end-to-end function, which does nothing but if this is some, we execute the things we say in this body of this function, and if this is none, we just do nothing, and then we convert it to an option. And the other thing is we convert it first to result with the OKOR function, which gets a string, and the OK case we then multiply by 2. The error case we print the error and then continue with our length, and at the end we check if either the error, if we have an error, is smaller than 10 or x is smaller than 10. Oh. So yeah, it's just chaining of methods here, which is pretty nice, and you will see that you do this pretty often with options, so that you don't have to use that many iflets and matchers, but can just use methods on your options and results and deal with them like this. If you go to the repository and select the solution branch, you will find the solution commits for the task until now. And they will also stay up there after the workshop, so you don't have to look at them just now. So we have now another bigger topic, which is still a bit, might be hard to understand because it goes into the functional programming language part of Rust. But don't be scared about functional programming and so on, which is called in Rust. It's just convenient if you use it a bit, and you will know to love it. One aspect is so-called closures. Oh, I never published a polling result. It's less and less. Okay, so closures, you can pass functions to your functions. That's nothing new. Like in C, you can also pass a pointer to a function and use that function. But in Rust, you have nice syntax for this. So for example, you can just define a closure like this. You have this bars, which contain all the return, all the arguments in them. In that case, we define this function to be function from usize to boolean. And then we can use all these things inside the closure. And yeah, we can either specify all the types on our closure, or we can just let the Rust compiler figure out our types on our closure, and that works pretty much all the time. And what we also can do is to go away, Paul. Is to just pass a function name into it. We don't have to produce a function pointer or something. We can just pass the name, and it will use this function inside the other function. So this is pretty useful in methods like the map method we saw just saw on options, and the same we can also do on iterators. To know what an iterator is, we want to look at for loops. In Rust, you don't have the classic for loops where you write I is 0, I is smaller than 10, I plus plus. You almost never need this because you have iterators in Rust, and you can just write this for each style loop in Rust. So you write for element in vector and dot iter, produce an iterator, and then you can just use the element and don't have to index into your vector or your array and get out of bounds exception or anything. So yeah, that's great. And if you need the index. You can also do this by calling the enumerate method on iterator, and then you get a tuple of your index and your element, and you can then use both inside a loop body. And then there are other convenience functions on iterator, but we are running out of time for this. For example, the filter method in this case takes a closure, what we just learned, takes the for each element, it takes in the value and then checks if the value is modulo 2 is 0, so is even. And if it's even, it will process the value and iterate in the for loop over this value. And this for loop for element in vec iter dot filter is even. And then inside this, it will only print all the even values inside a vector. Of course, Rust also has while loops, the classic while loop where you just check some variable against something else, and it will run until this is false. And then, as we saw with the iflet, the same you can do with whilelet. For example, you can also run an iterator.next is some element, and then you will get the same result as when you do it with the for element in the vec.iterator. Most of the time you should use this, but you will find that you sometimes rather use the whilelet syntax. It works just like iflet, just that it loops instead of only executing the body once. And yeah, here's a list about useful methods on iterators. Enumerate, we saw we get a useSize and a type, so index plus type. Map, we can map from one type to another every value in our iterator. Filter, we can filter out elements, and there are many, many more functions. The iterator documentation is really big. There are so many functions and methods you can use on iterators. For example, the iterEmpty function will create an empty iterator. You find that this is sometimes useful, or iterOnce will create an iterator with exactly one element. And yeah, when you get to know Rust, you get to know all the methods on iterators, or most of them. I also don't even know all the methods, and every time I look at the iterator documentation, I think there's a new method or something implemented on iterators. It's really big, and you can do really cool things with iterators. And here we have again the TurboFish. Dinner's ready. Yeah, I'm almost through with this part. Oh, yeah, that was my timer that I should go to the other stuff. Yeah, so iterators by themselves do absolutely nothing. So if you would call iterator.filter and call a print line in there, it won't print anything because iterators are lazily evaluated. If you want an iterator to do something, you have to use them either in a for loop or by collecting this iterator into a vector. So if you call the collect function, it will go through the iterator step by step and will push every element in the vector in an efficient way. And here we have again the TurboFish. It means collect, and we have to specify a type for this collect, so we specify that it should collect into a vector. And yeah, so we ran out of time. This was the first time I hold this workshop. We have now two options. Either you will still want to do all the tasks but then we can maybe only do this in the next task and won't get to other stuff in Rust, or I can just present to you everything else and then we finish without you doing any more tasks today. So press A if you want to continue doing tasks, but just do less this in this workshop, or B if you want to hear more about Rust and don't really care about doing the tasks just now, but want to do them after the workshop. So A, I want to do tasks, okay. Or B. That's pretty convincing. Okay, then I will continue with explaining Rust. So let's continue with awesome features of Rust. And the next awesome feature of Rust is the Rust documentation. So I recommend to you that you add born missing docs to the top of your crate, and then every public item you have, which you mark with pub in Rust. If you don't have documentation for this public item, Rust will warn you, or Rust will emit a warning. And documentation looks like this. If you want to document a complete file, you use // exclamation mark. And if you want to document a function or a struct or anything else, you use 3/. And yeah, Rust has different sections in its documentation, and it's a convention to put them in. There's an error section you use if you return a result, and then you describe when it returns error. There's a panic section if you call panic in your function and your program may abort if you use the wrong input, you document it in the panic section. There's a safety section if you use unsafe code, which is advanced Rust concept we won't get to today. And there's this great thing called the example section. And in the example sections, you put Rust code explaining how to use your function. So for example, we have this Rust code here, use, and then we import with the use statement our function into our documentation example. And then we assert something, for example, assert foo, and then we check that foo really returns true. And if we do this and then run a cargo test, cargo will during testing will also test all of our documentation. So if you write such code blocks inside your documentation, cargo will test your documentation and executed code that is inside this block. So if foo should for some reason return false, then if you run cargo test, it will emit an error and say this test failed in this documentation. This is especially great when you write documentation and your documentation sometimes get bit rotten because something changed in the function you implemented and then you forgot to adapt the documentation. But with doc comments like that, cargo test will test your doc comment, and if you change something critical inside your function, the doc test will fail and you will know about it during testing. Yeah, that is how cargo doc test looks like. So when we write this code block and run cargo test, then it says test libs foo is okay. And if we generate a documentation with cargo doc, in the end it looks like this. It has our example code here, how to use our function, how to import it, how to use it. We have all the other sections here, and a function name, a description, and everything you write here will be formatted here. You can even put in links to other structs in your documentation. You will see this if you look at the task after the workshop. Another thing in Rust, you want to structure your code in different modules. So you don't want to have one file where everything is in this one file like we have until now in our main.js file, but you want to structure your document, your project, your create. And you structure it by, on the one hand, splitting up your main RS file, so your binary and your library part, where you pretty much implement all the logic in your library part, and then just call from the main function some boilerplate you need, like passing input and so on, and then deal with all the logic stuff in the library part. And in addition to that, you want to create modules. Modules inside your library, you can then access with the syntax we saw in our doc comment, like this with use, doc test, the name of our grade, colon, colon, foo. That's how we access items inside our grade. So for example, if our grade is called dollar grade, we would access this this sum module with dollar grade colon colon sum module. Or if we have nested grades, we put a mod rs file here, which can be accessed with grade with the directory name, and subgrades of this nested grade, submodules of this nested module can then be accessed one level deeper. Yeah, this pretty much looks then like this. You define your modules in your librs file, and then you can use them like this. Use nested foo, then it will get the function from foo, and you can just use the function here. And that's it for this part. Any questions? Okay, then we're moving on. So I wasn't sure if I should put this chapter into this part of the presentation or into the advanced Rust part, so I like to just skim over this because of the little time we have left. So pretty much what this says is you can use generics in Rust. So for example, if you want to write a struct that holds a vector, you can put a generic argument here, and then you can use the generic inside the struct. And if you implement a struct, you can define the generic parameter after the impl, and then use the generic parameter all in this impl block. And you can also do this for a single function. So if you don't want to do this for a whole struct or whole enumeration, you can just do this on a single function and just use it after, define the generic parameter after the function name, and then use it in the argument type or return type or anywhere in the function body. Fun fact, this identity function is one-to-one in the Rust standard. So you can use standard ops identity, and you can this method, this function is in the standard library of Rust. What you also can do is define bounds of your traits, so properties of your generics or properties your generic should have. For example, we can say that our generic should implement display, which means that we can print out this type. And we can only then pass types that implement display and can be printed. This is something like in Java when you bind a generic to an interface or something. This is pretty much the same. And we can either specify the bound directly after defining the generic parameter, or we can use the where clause where we define the bounds later. This is you use this former method if you have only some bounds but not too many, and the later method if you have too many bounds, so that it doesn't fit anymore in one line, and then you define just the where clause and define all your bounds for your generic parameters. There are functions out there in crates that have like 10 lines of where clause where different generic parameters are defined back and forth. Yeah, that gets pretty wild for some use cases. Yeah, the topic of lifetimes, this would take about 10 minutes to explain, so I want to skip that. It's also, I also explained it in the task, so if you're interested in it, you can try to do the task on your own after the workshop, or as I recommend, after workshop and you want to keep with Rust, I recommend that you read the Rust book. And now the last topic about basic Rust is traits. Traits, you can think about of traits like interfaces in Java, for example. And in traits, you define functions that you want to implement afterwards for your types. So for example, you have a struct S and a trait T, and the trait T defines two methods. One method is the foo method, and one method is the bar method. And afterwards, you want to implement the T for your struct S, and then you have to actually provide the implementation. In the trait, you don't have to provide implementation, but you can provide an implementation. In the implementation of the trait for some struct, you have to always provide the implementation. So you can't leave this to a subclass or substruct. That's nothing that exists in Rust, but you have to define the function body here. What you can do, but don't have to do, if a trait already defines a function body, you can redefine it in the implementation for your struct, or you can just leave it out. So in this case, you can just leave out bar, and it will still work, because bar is already defined in the crate, in the trait, and has a default implementation. Also, the standard library offers you some traits like the add trait, and if you implement the add trait for your struct or your type, then you can, for example, use the plus operator on your type and just add types together like integers, or structs together like integers, and yeah. That's pretty much overriding operators in C++, just that you can't override operators, but add operators to types. Yeah, traits can be pretty powerful. We saw before that, for example, the iterator, iterator is a trait, and iterator has all these methods like filter, enumerate, map, map or, and so on. And we can get all these methods on our type if we just implement the next function. So if we want all the methods like any, next on our type, then we just have to implement next from the iterator trait in some way or another, and then we get all of these functions. This implementation is kind of bad because next always returns sum. That means this is an infinite iterator, so if you try to iterate over it, you get into an infinite loop. And yeah, that's bad. But yeah, so trades are pretty powerful because you can request the implementation of only one method and then give functionality of many other methods just by implementing this one method. So if you implement next just as a regular method, so if you don't write impl iterator for s, so but only write impl s and then implement next on s, that won't give you all the methods because it's just then it's just some method on s. But if you implement it in the sense of a trade implementation, it will give you all the methods implemented on the trade. It doesn't matter if the methods are implemented in the impl for your struct or in the trade directly. You will have access to all of the methods of the iterator, but you have to implement every method of the trade that doesn't have implementation provided. So for example, for this trade T, you can't leave out the foo method. You have to implement it, but you can leave out the bar method and it will be given to you for free. Also, if you should do this, impl s and then implement next and mut self, Clippy will warn. Clippy will emit an error about this and say, hey, you probably wanted to implement iterator for your type and not just a method next. Ah, if the compiler can distinguish, so if you implement, you can, I think you can implement the iterator trait with the next method and then implement a special next method just on S. There is a way that the compiler can distinguish it, but you have to explicitly write which method you mean. Does this answer your question? So if you have duplicate methods on your type, then you have to specify which method you want to call. I don't want to get in the syntax for this though, because I always forget the syntax for this. It's a little bit complicated. So if you implement it as a trait, then two traits can have the same named method. Yes, that's possible. Yeah, so for example, for the equal trait or the partial equals trait or the debug trait, you don't have to implement this if every type in your struct implements this. You can just use the derive key, derive attribute, and the Rust compiler will generate a code for you and implement all of this. And then you can just use it like debug printing, which is done with the colon question mark syntax in your formatting string, or you can compare your structs just by deriving everything. You don't have to implement everything. Yeah, all the useful traits like equal, debug, hash, you can just derive for your struct if every type inside your struct, every field implements this trait. So, yeah, that's it for the basic Rust stuff. I would offer that we now do a Q&A session, the last 20 minutes, and afterwards, if people want to stay, I will explain a little bit embedded Rust. If you don't want to stay because it's already late, you can go. Don't feel bad about it, but now I want to do a Q&A session with you. So go ahead and ask any questions about Rust. So how does derive work? Can user-defined traits be derived, or do you need to teach the compiler how to do that for each trait individually, and if so, how? The answer to your second question is yes to both. Yes, you can derive individual traits, but you have to tell the compiler how to do it. How to do it is something called proc macro. Proc macro is a procedural macros. Proc macros is Rust code you write that generates other Rust code if you add attributes like the derive attribute. So the derive attribute is a proc macro provided by the Rust compiler, which generates code for your Rust code written in Rust. Proc macros are pretty advanced Rust, so I don't want to get into it too much. But in the Rust book, there's an example how to write such a proc macro so you can derive your own traits. Okay. Any more questions about the Rust language? Yeah, those questions can also be meta questions, like when should I use Rust, or yeah, or something like that. Which Rust book do you recommend? Rust has its own book written by all the people interested in Rust, and it's linked in the shared notes. I will also link it in chat real quick. So you don't have to buy a book. You can just read online the official Rust book. I really recommend it. It's quite a long read. It has 20 chapters and really many examples. I used it to create this workshop, and yeah. So yeah, this is a list of books I recommend. Oh, Rustlings, good that you found this. Rustlings is also a collection of many good examples for Rust beginners. And yeah, I would recommend doing that. Yeah, I never done it myself, but I heard really good things about Rustlings. I think the other Philip has opinions on Rustlings. Ah, yeah. Yeah, it also might be that my examples cover everything Rust covers, because I tried to get everything in 4 hours, but I spectacularly failed at this, as it turns out. So yeah, maybe my examples don't cover everything, but I try to cover pretty much everything with my examples. Yeah, but I don't say that my examples are better than Rustlings or worse. I would say Rustlings is probably better or more complete because it's compiled by more people than just me. Sivan, which book do you mean? Ah, yeah, it's the same. I think the Rust book on No Starch website is optimized again, so it is better as a physical book, but the content of it is pretty much the same, yes. So if you like a physical book more, you can buy the book on the Starch website, and if you don't care about having a physical book, the Rust book on the official Rust book on online also works. Good night, DSM. Merry Christmas to you too. The slides are already available inside the repository. If you go to the presentation folder, there is the ODP file and the PDF file. There are 118 slides, and I got to about 70 of them. So yeah, the learning of today is that this workshop is not for 4 hours, but at least for a complete day of Rust. So yeah. If there aren't any more questions, I want to recommend the final project or your first Rust project I prepared for you for this workshop. I like the idea I had. And it's just a bit fun and covers more Rust things, and you can do it or just don't do it. I will just quickly present it to you. So the final project would be, now it's homework for you, to build your own zoo. You have two objectives. You get animals, and animals shouldn't eat each other. And you should put your animals in as few cages as possible. And you have to adhere to some rules. For example, you will be provided a JSON file where all the animals are defined with a name, a species, strength, and carnivore, and a solution file. And animals with the same species should go in the same cage so that they aren't alone. And if you have a carnivore, you can't put one carnivore in the same cage as another carnivore. And a carnivore will eat another animal if it's a carnivore, obviously, if the carnivore is stronger than the other animal. And if the animals are different species, there is no cannibalism between carnivores. And another thing, if two carnivores of different species are equally strong, they won't eat each other. And yeah, the algorithm for this, for everything of this, is already implemented, so you don't have to implement this. What you have to do is fill out some functions, like in the animal thing, you have to implement the partial equal traits for animals. So, or you have to implement the comparison function for animals and so on. And then in the lib file, you should implement all the other fun stuff to get this to work. And to get this to work, you can run cargo tests at the end. And cargo test will now tell you every test failed, And you know that you're done if when you run cargo tests at the end, it will tell you everything passed. So if you're finished, it will look like this, everything passed and you're happy. I will push the solution of everything up after a workshop. So if you just want to look at a solution how you would have to do this, you can do this if you want to do it yourself and then compare it to the solution. You can also do this. Yeah, that's the final project I prepared for you. Now it's homework. And yeah, that would be it for me for the official part of the workshop. If you want to stay and want to get a presentation about embedded Rust on a RISC-V microcontroller, you can do that. If not, that's it for the workshop. And yeah, if you have still any questions, please ask. Oh, I have to forgot to talk. Two things noch. If you're interested in contributing to Rust open source projects, there are many open source projects out there, and the Rust community is really welcoming and open, and you don't have to sign any contributor agreements or something like you may know from GCC or the other GNU projects. You can just fork the repository, open a PR, and if your PR gets accepted, you successfully contributed to the repository. If you, for example, are interested in compilers, come to Rust Clippy, a little self-promotion. We all always like new contributors. We help you out to get started. We have great documentation how to get started. If you think the documentation lacks, then tell us. But if you're not interested in compilers, rather interested in IDEs, for example, you can contribute to Rust Analyzer. It's also open source. If you're interested in web stuff, there's Actix Web, which is in benchmarks one of the best tools in the thing it does. I don't do web, so I don't really know what it does. Yeah, for async, there are multiple crates. So if you want to contribute to async await stuff, you can do this. For databases, there's things. And last but not least, there is the webpage crates.io. Which is a list of all the crates everyone ever published in Rust. So if you need something, you can first look it up on crates.io or just Google for it. Probably someone has implemented it already. And then you can just go to your cargo terminal. And for example, write clap, the command line arguments, clap is version number, and then you can use everything clap provides for you. You don't have to download shadowy files or something. Cargo will compile everything for you and download for you and just build it, and it works. Okay. To get in with the Rust community, I recommend the Discord server. You can just join. There are many Rust beginners there which will answer questions or where you can ask questions. There are also experienced Rust developers and contributors there. So yeah, join the Discord server, get in touch with the community. It's a great community. I never was in a better open source community than that. So yeah, Rust has a great community. And yeah, if you get started with Rust, there's this webpage, Awesome Rust Mentors, and there are a list of people who are willing to provide some support if you have questions about specific Rust topics, me included. just shoot them an email or contact them on Zulip, Discord or something, and they probably will answer your question. So you can reach out to me either via email, philip.kronas@embecosm.com. On GitHub, my username is flip9095, Discord the same, Zulip the same, and I have a website which is currently empty and probably will stay empty because I don't really do web stuff. Yeah. And now I want to show off my last slide. Here's Ferris again. And yeah, that's it for today. Thank you all. So this time that was really it. I don't have anything else, except you're interested in embedded Rust. Then you can stay. Yeah, sure. I also, if people stay for the embedded stuff, I'll also record it. Otherwise, you can go through the slides or read the embedded Rust book. It probably explains stuff better than I can, because I rarely do embedded Rust anymore. I only know the pain from 2 years ago. Okay.